message is an issue of the heart. An issue of the heart. Thank you, Lord. So, when it comes to finances, churches have different views. Like there are two extremes in the body of Christ. One extreme is some of the church says that if you are not blessed, you're not prospering, if you don't have a car, if you don't have a house or money, that God is not blessing you. God is not really working in your life. And there's another extreme too that says that if you are, it's okay to be poor. That's the other extreme. It's okay to not to have money. It's okay to not all your needs taken care of because you are being humbled and you are being much closer to God. Because when you don't have money, you will be so close to God that you will always pray to Him, Lord, please give me this, give me that. So you're dependent upon God. So we would say that these are two extremes, and we just want to kind of balance it a little bit about finances. We want to balance it. So let's read these verses. We'll be reading from Mark 10. Thank you, Lord. So I'll tell you the story about this. Let's have a word of prayer. Thank you, God. Father, we pray that your word will come in power, will come with conviction, will come with the Holy Spirit and revelation. Be with us, O God, even as we study your word. And Father, test our heart. Check our hearts. Help us to see if our hearts is right, especially in the area of finances. Help us to be open and transparent to you in this area. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So here in Mark 10, as Jesus started in his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. Good teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Why do you call me good? Jesus answered, no one is good except God alone. You know the commandments, you shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony, you shall not defraud, honor your father and mother. Teacher, he declared, all this I have kept since I was a boy. And Jesus looked at him and loved him. Say, love him. One thing you lack, he said, go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had a great wealth. So in this story, this young man is very sincere because when he saw Jesus, he ran after him and he even kneeled down and said, what should I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said, do not murder. And Jesus said, do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not defraud anyone. Honor your father and mother. And he said, do not steal. Do not give false testimony. And what's the answer of that young man? He said, I'm doing this since I was a boy. Wow, he's a good guy, right? He's a good guy. But not all the good guy would go to heaven. That's kind of not a very good news, right? Because if we are just good, we don't need Jesus. Jesus doesn't need to die on the cross because we just need to be good. So we could see here he's a good guy and trying to please God. And what did Jesus responded to him? So, Jesus look at him and love him. Wow, what a nice response of Jesus, right? he did not kind of accuse him, or he did not kind of condemn him like, you sinner, you'll go to hell. But he just looked at him and just loved him. Wow, what a tender heart. What a merciful heart. When Jesus told him the real issue, it's about one thing you lack, go and sell all your possession and give it to the poor. So this is now becoming a problem, his heart, because he felt so lonely after that, because he has so much great wealth. So maybe some of us doesn't have this kind of issue in our heart. Maybe you don't have problem about giving away your property or your finances. But to this guy, this matters so much. And I believe most of us, this is one of the hindrances that keeps us away from going to God. So, you know, when you have money, especially in the system of the world, is like, if you have money, you are happy. If you have money, you have control of your life, you have control of people, and it will be much easier. So, this is the system of the world, like introducing also what we call the religion of materialism. What is important is money, making God as money, making money as God. So it's not making God as money, making money as God. All right, so we could see here that it's a problem for a man who has so much money, because it means to say he won't have control anymore of his life. So Jesus had to deal him about this, because this is the one that's hindering him in coming to know God. God wants an absolute control. God wants us to give our trust unto him. God wants us, God doesn't want to help us to have a control over our life, but he wants to have a control over our life, not ourselves. Because if we will have control of our life, it will be disastrous, because we don't know really what's the best. And of course, having that money, it says in the Bible that the love for money is the root of evil. It's not wrong to have money, but if the money is having you, that's the problem. The money is owning you. I have to work 24/7. I can't go to church. I can't build a relationship. I don't have time for a relationship. So that's what's happening usually. It's the love for money. Like, you would do everything so that you would get in life and be able to get ahead, even to the point of compromising your conviction, compromising your Christian belief, and even compromising to the point of for women, sometimes to the point of selling their bodies. And for men, sometimes, you know, like maybe selling drugs in order to get money, or being involved in many, many wicked things in order to have money. So that is why it says that the love for money is the root of all evil. Amen? And usually, money that comes so quickly, you know, dito sa Pinas, ano, like there are so many, what do you call that, scam. Did you receive an email like telling you that you are privileged to receive $60 million, $10 million? And then they explain what you will do. And if you kind of bite that, o kung kakagat ka dyan, they will tell you what you should do. Just like one of our member in Cabanato 101, one of our attender, and she told me, Pastora, you know what? I'm going to get lots of money. It's just the two of us, it's okay? Would that be okay? And I said, yes. And then she told me how would it go. Like she received a letter from the email, and they get her address, their phone number, and they keep on calling her, and wants to go to her house and telling her, we will give you this money. We have like 500,000 pesos, but you will keep it in your house. So, but I told her from the first time, that is a scam. Don't believe in that. Don't believe in that. It's not true. You'll just waste your time. You'll just be worrying. You'll just be, you'll just have some miserable life if you entertain that. And that's what happened, because she keeps on entertaining the person until, like, she can't sleep anymore because of some threat she's having and some they will meet and they will go to her house. So I told her, if they are going to your house, you better stop it. So how many of us goes to that? How many of us, pag sinabi, like, you'll have lots of money here. Quick money to. So if that is the case, there's no really what we call the quick money. Quick problem, yes. We will have a quick problem. But quick money easily goes away. Or it has some trap if you will bite into that. So, like what I said, love for money is the root of all evil. So God, Jesus, is concerned about the issue of his heart, because his heart was tested. His heart was tested. So it says here that he leave Jesus lonely and sad. His face fell because of that situation. God wants to bless us. Amen? God wants to bless us. That's the balance. God wants to bless us, but God wants to test the condition of our heart. Because if the condition of our heart is like we're greedy for money or trying to do everything just to get money, we will fall into many temptations. It says here, I would like to read this in First Timothy 6. It says, godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. Those who want to get rich fall into temptation and trap and into many foolish, harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. So many people like this. Because they want money, they would go abroad. And going abroad really promised things. And they left their husband, they left their kids. And when they come back, the husband is not there. The kids are not there anymore. So it's a trap. We cannot exchange family and their future with just money. Amen? I know somebody, very matured Christian, kind of, serving God. But he kind of, like, involved himself so much in gold digging. Gold digging, going to from place to place, and they would dig, and they would try to follow where the gold is. He has a family, he has a good education, serving the Lord, but because of this desire to get more gold, he spent like 20 years doing that. And at the last minute of his life, the trust and confidence of people was not there anymore because he has so many debts. He has so many debts. He borrowed money from different people and promised to pay but did not. And, you know, his faith and his serving God, all of those were taken away from him because of so much love for money. And now they don't have money. Like what the gold is promising, that they will have more gold and more money. It's not true, right? So easy money is not really, it's not really reliable. If you want money, you have to work and you have to, of course, you have to really put your time and effort in there. But don't allow yourself to be, to make that money or that profession to be your God, that you have, don't have any more time for family and even for a relationship with God. So Jesus is, look to this guy and love him. And he told him what needs to be done. I believe that there are times in our lives that God will speak to us. The test is, are we willing to give it to God? Are we willing to ask, to allow God to control us? Are we willing to surrender everything to God? That's the question in this situation. Because his heart issue is, he really loves money. So he left, like, sad over that situation. And the disciple says here, let's continue the verses. The disciples were amazed, verse 24, at his words. But Jesus again said, children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, who then can be saved? So from this paragraph, Jesus said, it is easier for a camel to go to the eye of the needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. So the eye of a needle here, it could also signify from Cambridge commentaries, the eye of the needle here is a literal door. In Jerusalem, because before Jerusalem is walled around, and there is the main gate, the big gate where the, you know, where those with luggages would go enter in with their animals and their belongings. And there's a small gate called an eye of the needle on the east side. They call it an eye of the needle because the one who could go in to that small door is just one person. And for a camel to go in, although they still allow the camel to go in, what they would do is they would make the camel really, really bend their knees and go slow, and they have to remove all the things that this camel is carrying. I remember when I was in Mozambique, I was privileged, or we had fun riding a camel. And I noticed the camel, they know how to kneel down. Like, you know, they're just waiting there, kneeling down for every people to ride on them. It seems that they are trained to kneel down. But anyway, I remember this door. An eye of a needle, wherein they describe that a camel can go in there without stooping down, kneeling down, and getting slowly to fit their body. And they have to remove all the belongings that this camel is saying. So same with us, if we want to enter the kingdom of God, we need to come into the terms of God, his own terms. What's his condition? not our condition. Sometimes, Lord, I'll go, I'll obey you if I would win with the lotto, in the lotto, or if I would have a promotion, or if I would have a loan, I'll follow you. We don't go to God like that. We are not the one giving him the terms, but he is the one giving us the terms. So, there's a verse in the Bible that says, enter a narrow gate, for the end of it is life. But if you enter the wide road, the end of it is destruction. So, we have to enter with a broken heart, repentant, like that donkey in the eye of the needle. We need to come to God humbly and slowly and really thinking it through. God, do you want me to really go here? Can I pay the price? Would I be willing to do what you want me to do? Will I be willing to really have you have the full control over my life? Would I be able to do that? So we should be able to think and be able to really go humbly, slowly, and think about it. But praise God, because Jesus said, with man, ano sabi? This is impossible. But with God, nothing is impossible. Amen? Nothing is impossible. Even the rich man could enter the kingdom of heaven. You know, you heard about Francis de Assisi, wherein he's a saint, wherein he was raised up in a luxurious homes. Rich comes from a wealthy family, but because he has an encounter with God, he saw a vision and hear God, he's willing to give it all and made a vow of poverty in order to be devoted to Christianity, helping the poor and doing all the services for others. So, it's not impossible, amen? And then it says here, Peter spoke up and said, we have left everything to follow you. Okay? Truly, I tell you, ito yung reply ni Jesus. Come on, are you there? Are you listening? Are you ready for this? Amen? God is good, amen? We have a good news, some good news here. All right, so Jesus said to Peter, who left everything that they have in order to follow Jesus. It says here, no one who has left home, or brothers, or sisters, or mothers, or fathers, or children's, or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much as this present age. Homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, fields, along with persecution, and in the age to come, eternal life. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a praise for that. Huminga kayo ng konti. All right, so makita natin, we could see here that God is really looking with the motives of our hearts. What are we really serving? Are we serving God or are we serving our money? If God dealt with you with money and said, all of your saving, all of your retirement that you've been saving when you get old, I want you to give that to me. All right? Will you be able to say, yes, God? Maybe from some of us would do that, others would think. It's better to think it slowly and then make a decision than says, yes, Lord, and then not able to do it, right? So God is more concerned about us loving God than loving money, serving God and not money. So praise the Lord, because it says here that with God, it is, with man, it's impossible, but with God, it's possible. So look at this. Peter. Peter had his own business. Like during those times, fishing, if you are fishing and you have your own boat, that's a good business already. If you have a fields, agriculture, that's the way they have businesses. You are rich already, wealthy already. And they said, we left all of that. We left all of that. There's one verse in the Bible that said, we can say, we can really kind of check our hearts if we are really his disciples. When Jesus said in one of the gospel, it says here that he who does not hate his father, his mother, his children, his brother or sister, and they that love them more than me is not worthy to become my disciples. If anyone would come to me and will not deny themselves and carry their cross and follow me, cannot be my disciple. Who of you who would kind of build a house and does not stop first and think and count the cost? And later on says that they would build it and they were not able to build it. So these are some of the questions we have to ask ourselves. It's a heart issue. Heart issue. Am I willing, oh God, to give this to you? Am I willing? Am I willing to surrender my life to you, God? I remember itong verse na ito, like, sabi ni Jesus said, he who left his home, his brother or sister or children or friends for the gospel, for me and the gospel, will never fail to receive much more than this. Amen? I remember when the courting days of Pastor Rich and I, okay lang ba sa inyo yan? Alright, that was long time ago, but just becoming very clear to me. When he was still courting me, he's a poor missionary. He's living in a small apartment with a Filipino family near a street of squatters area. And he's ministering weekly. Sometimes he would be assigned to go to Tibagin Island, which is in Malolos. It's an island when it rained hard, the whole island is deep in water up to here. So he would walk there in that whole island. And when he goes to go and get his bath, he will have a bath dun sa poso. What is poso in English? So it's a common place to do your washing and other things. So he will wash himself, bath himself there. Of course, naka-short naman siya, no? Nakakaya naman hindi. Naka-short. And he's just living with a family there. And when they go to the bathroom to do their thing, nakikigamit lang sila. They are just using another house to do that. So that's how poor he is. And while he's courting me, he told me, Ning, I cannot promise you a house. I cannot promise even your own bathroom. Ladies, I can promise you a car. I can promise that I will always be with you, because there are times God will tell me to go there and maybe I need to leave you, because we have already kids then and they are still young to bring them all around. And so that really make me think so hard, like, do I have a future with this guy? You know, but because I'm not saying yes to him, but I'm saying yes to God. I know when I say yes to him, I'm saying yes to God, because God has a call in my life. I was so grateful that the Lord saved me from, you know, a fatal sickness that I almost died. Like, so miraculous that I experienced that after that, I told God, Lord, do everything in my life. I volunteer. Count me in. Amen? So, hindi po ako naghintay ng, like, God, may calling ka ba sa akin? I want to serve. But I volunteer. Yes, God, I want to serve you, God. And I would say, dito sa verses na ito, katulad ng pangako ng Lord for Peter. Now, praise God, by His grace, we have our own two big houses. We have mission base here at Fairview. 3 floors and also 1 mission base in Cabanatuan City. And I have my own car, and my husband has his own car, and all our families, our kids are blessed. Blessed, so much blessing. I don't want to tell you, baka mainggit kayo. Alright? So palakpakan natin ang Panginoon. God is good. He is good. He is able. Whatever He promised, if you give it to Him, He will multiply it. But what is the issue in your heart? Are you willing to allow God to surrender everything to Him, even your finances? Okay? Even all the blessing that you have. Are you willing to allow God? God, yes. Yes, I give it to you, Lord. I give it to you. Of course, through that, our life, through that years of life together, we exercise also being generous, giving. We give our first house. We give our first building. We give our, we were not able to give our first car, but the third car. We always give our purse to God because He deserved the best. Amen? Because He is the first that we should put in our lives. Let's all stand up. Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Can we have someone to play the organ? Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, God. Bless you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's just pray. Let's this be an issue of the heart. Who holds your life? Who controls your life? Is it the money? Is it the material things? The property that you have? Who controls your life? Are you the one controlling your own life? That would be miserable because it's hard to control our lives. God has a better things for us. Thank you, Lord. As our head, let our head just bow, and as our head bows and our eyes close, I just want us to really talk to God one-on-one. Let there be a check in our heart. Let there be a test in our hearts when it comes to finances. Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Bless you, God. Thank you, Father, for your goodness, for your faithfulness. God, thank you for the blessing. Thank you, Father. We bless you. We love you. Thank you, God. I want to use this time to challenge some people here who had not really received the Lord Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Maybe you have not yet experienced the love and the forgiveness of God in your life. I want you to just raise your hands, and I want to lead you in a prayer of acceptance. Just want you to raise your hands and say, yes, God. Yes, God, I raise my hands to you, Father. I raise my hands to you, Jesus. I want to know you, Jesus. I want to know you, who gave your life to me. I want to know you, who sacrificed yourself for me.